Good afternoon. Welcome to Creating ZOLA Mondays. We're so happy you're joining us this afternoon. It is so important to talk about the most powerful force in the universe, which is love. So ZOLA to us, Bantu folk in Kikongo and Zulu means love. Love, more than love, I guess, is peace, tranquility, and productivity. So that's what we want to do today. We want to talk about creating ZOLA and actually wielding those powerful forces. So we have with us today our usual team. And, I'm sorry, I'm Linda James Myers, who is our moderator today. I am past president of ABSI, as well as distinguished psychologist and elder of elders emeritus of the Council of Elders. So welcome. And Dr. G, would you introduce yourself?
Yes, greetings. I'm a past treasurer of ABSI and a past president of its Delaware Valley chapter. I'm a developmental psychologist by training, and I've shifted from college professor career to an applied career in IO, industrial organizational. I do leadership coaching and consulting nationwide. Glad to be with you.
I'm very good. JoJo?
Yeah, I was going to hop in. I'm JoJo. I'm a third year clinical PsyD student at the Chicago School of Professional Psychology. I work closely with the social media virtual impact team with some of these lovely people here today, and I'm super excited to be here per usual.
Thank you. Robina?
Hey, y'all. I'm Robina. I am the communications chair for the student circle, and I am a counseling psychology PhD candidate, and I also work with the social media impact team.
Great, and Evan is back with us this week.
Yeah, hey everybody. My name is Evan Auguste. I am the student circle chair, the Sawubona Healing Circle chair, and a doctoral candidate in clinical / forensic psychology. And also, I've been told we have to remind everybody, don't forget to share on social media so we can expand the conversation, expand the ZOLA, so everybody, please do that at your earliest convenience.
Well, we had such a good conversation last time. We wanted to make a part two. And what we did is try to call some of the comments from the last session. But I wanted to share today from classical African civilization. Oftentimes, we don't know the history of love in an African cultural tradition. I was very surprised to learn that as far back as 2780 BC, Tahotep wrote out the instructions, and one of them was on the art of love. Isn't that surprising? And I will also share one of the poems from that section that I found very surprising. This gentleman says, 7 days since I last saw my beloved, longing presses heavy on me. My body is weighed down and I even forget the taste of life. When doctors come to tend me, their remedies leave me cold. Magicians have no potent spells. None can diagnose my illness. If I am told, see, there she is, I'm revived. Her name is what calms me. Her messages coming and going, that's what bonds my heart to life. My beloved heals me better than any medicine. She is for me more than a prescription. Her visit is my protective charm. When I see her, I regain my health. When she opens her eyes, my body grows young. When she speaks, I grow strong. When I take her in my arms, she drives away all evil, but she's been away 7 whole days now. I think that the idea that love and loving and romance comes from Western cultural tradition is really ill-founded. But what we do know is not only did that exist, but we also need to learn about what grounded that love. Because Maat, which is the foundational teachings of that time, is really the embodiment of love and peace and truth and justice, had to be foundational to make that real and a practical lived tradition. with such great success. So I couldn't resist reading that and sharing that this afternoon. Any thoughts?
I think it's interesting because when, as you were reading it, I was thinking of the conversation that we had about falling in love versus choosing to be in love. And from how it's described, I think that's how typically like we, or in society, I think of what falling in love looks like. It's like, oh, you seem to be infatuated with this person, or you can't, you know, stop thinking about them. And, you know, the person said that their name is what calms them. So I think all those kind of things together make me think of what we were saying about falling in love versus like choosing to be in love is what came to mind.
Well, hopefully the choosing and falling commingle. And one of the things we do know is that the intention is that capacity human beings have for being in love is designed to perpetuate the best of the human tradition. So from that angle, I think most people feel being in love is a really good feeling and it's very helpful. And I was very taken by the fact that this gentleman had been away from the woman for 7 days and was so very enthralled. And I think our challenge today in terms of creating and wielding Zola is how do we channel that very positive and powerful energy to the most positive and constructive relationships?
Yeah, I thought that was a really interesting excerpt, Nana Linda. And it makes me think about how you said there could be maybe a fine balance between falling and choosing love, because I'm thinking about now the neurology of it and how there have been some connections between falling in love and like drug addiction and like how dopamine kind of pumps in the brain when you're falling in love. So I think I'm going to start thinking about it like that, because 2 weeks ago I was really huge, like a huge proponent of choosing love, but I definitely think there's some type of subconscious aspect to it. So that was a really cool excerpt, and I definitely need to get my hands on that book.
Okay. Theophile Obenga. Obenga's a really brilliant Egyptologist. He's a student of Diop. So he's one of the people who we can read and count on and know he's talking, knows what he's talking about. The physiology of love is very helpful. Very helpful. Now then, the challenge is, what are the boundaries? What are the parameters? What are the steps? And we talked last time about self-love being essential and the basis for all love. And where that self-love's coming from is the realization of one's connection to the divine, which one finds oneself within and which is one in every human being. So when we give up that false sense of self of believing we are all the external criteria of our looks, our income, our position, our education, blah, 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 and really step out of that and understand we're intrinsically worthy because we are the individual and unique expression of an infinite creative life force, and dwell in that presence, that's the true self. And that's the self that can really create the kind of Zola that we need.
Yeah, I was gonna just speak really quickly to one of the other things that I think you guys talked about last week, which was the how amazing and encouraging and exciting being infatuated and feeling that type of love that isn't kind of like you were saying, like isn't just based in a Western understanding of love, like it's existed for centuries, thousands of years before that. But it's also how scary that is too, right? Like even after you develop that level of self-love, in the passage, he talks about wanting something to be able to cure him, like not knowing what's afflicting him, right? Like once you even achieve that level of maybe self-love and encouragement and self-satisfaction, that another person is capable of kind of throwing that all out of whack, right? That being a scary kind of process. I thought that was actually really interesting too, is that it's always kind of been this diurnal thing where it's like, you want this as much as you're afraid of it. And it's the give and take there.
Well, I think the fact that he considered her his medicine suggests that it was reciprocal, at least to a certain extent. But I do know exactly what you're speaking of in terms of the challenge of really stepping out there. And some people are afraid to be happy. Some people are afraid to feel joy and love because it is scary to them. And it's scary to them because of the past experiences that they've had and what's happened to them.
I think, Nana Linda, you bring up a really good point about people being scared to fall in love. Also, I did want to, again, encourage people to share this on their pages. We are actively monitoring the chat. And my dog is like flipping out right now. I was going to talk about last week or 2 weeks ago, we mentioned trauma bonding, which is something that might be kind of inherent in Black love because of the century-long years of oppression. And so I was wondering what y'all thought about that, because I don't think that we spent enough time on it because we were running out of time. And it was such a good conversation. But how do you all think that trauma bonding plays a role in Black love?
For me, when you don't acknowledge the trauma and you're still at the effect of it, then it's a very powerful force in very unconscious ways. So you're still very much trapped in the dominant culture's definition of what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, the standards of beauty, all of those things are part of the trauma. So without any kind of examination and clarification, then it's going to contribute to very challenged relationships, probably relationships that won't last very long, and certainly won't be able to escape that facade that comes with the Western traumatization.
I think that a lot of the times, because we are so plagued with what relationships should look like, and I'm talking about like in the media and pop culture, we're often looking for people to save us from our trauma instead of growing together and separately. We're looking for people to kind of complete us and fill the voids that we have from whatever trauma we experience.
Absolutely true. And rather than figuring out how to go through the trauma together, like we now become a unified force against the trauma, but yeah, we have to be mindful.
Yeah, I think that's a good point that you just said about going through it together, because I think, especially within the Black community, it's so common that we're probably all traumatized in some way. We're even thinking of like Dr. Joy DeGray's post-traumatic slave syndrome, there's like some remnants of trauma in a lot of folks. And I feel like what it's done to the Black community is, instead of some of us working through it together, it's that it's almost put us against each other in a lot of ways, because we don't know how to work through it for ourselves and then have that healthy relationship together, to the point that you made in part one about healing ourselves and then being able to be in relationship with one another. But maybe some people aren't able to do that. So how can we do it together and not be against one another while we're in the relationship? Because that trauma is likely gonna be there, and healing takes forever.
That's true. It's a process. Your thoughts, Dr. G?
Yeah, I wanted to dive in, and what was coming up for me is the trauma is a given. It's never post, it's always perennial. It's always happening. So that's a given. And it seems like if we go back to what Nana Linda just said about groundedness, that we would be looking and thinking about what are the spaces that we actually have to allow us to examine things together. It seems like the current trauma-producing society also has a script that says go off as a couple, and your relationship with love is yours, and people don't really think about it like we just described it, that supposedly we actually examine the script together, but we don't have spaces like that. So it got me to thinking about what we miss when we don't have spaces to really examine deep concepts like complementarity. What I heard in the poem was complementarity. I heard in the poem the possibility that everything's dynamic. So that's the real deal. You know, his comfort, his feelings change. he says, with you, I regain my life. So the sense of having a life changes, so everything's dynamic, including, I think, this concept of fear, that what we need to start doing is actually understanding fear as a part of our intelligence. And it's given us some sensitivity to something that's alerting us. So if fear were thought of as a short-term alerting device, it would get us thinking and examining what do we need to do to support ourselves. And the scary part then becomes something worthy of examination, because maybe you're supposed to be afraid quickly so that you can actually be in examination mode, inspection, reflection, and come up with something better. What gets me frustrated about the model is, I think the people reducing the trauma actually want us to compete, and they want us to self-destruct. So when we get together without groundedness in our deep philosophy, I think it's very easy to come up with an agenda that's self-serving, an agenda that sort of numbs some of the pain of our trauma without really thinking about complementing each other as partners. So I wonder, can a couple do it? It seems like a couple is a very unstable unit of energy to actually be grounded unless they are connected with something bigger than themselves. That makes sense?
Absolutely. I think definitely the key is being each connected to something greater than themselves. And then when they come together, they can be expressing and growing in that presence.
I wonder, and please put me back on track if this is a little bit a little bit off, but I wonder sometimes in, I guess, the conversation around kind of like you're saying, like trauma, and whether the couple is a unit that can actually sufficiently explore, I guess, the complete options of love and moving just past trauma and maybe towards more of an optimal kind of love and whatnot. One of the things that I constantly think of, and this might be a little bit of a different topic, is when we think about all these concepts and these ideas that we use to kind of govern and measure our commitment to one another and our love for one another. One of the things, like you talk about, whenever the passage that framed this whole conversation was written, like how long were relationships, right? Like how long were people actually committed to one another? Like what was the life expectancy? When were people actually getting engaged with one another? Were they at similar maturity levels, right? And so to the point about being creative and needing to reimagine new ways to do it. I mean, part of the thing may be like, what about the idea that maybe couples aren't the unit that are supposed to be able to be forever captured within one another, right? Like even a success, like you have a completely successful marriage and maybe that's successful for 30 years, but then you get to a particular place and the other person gets to a particular place where at this stage, at this juncture, we are no longer the people for one another, right? Like what would that look like to normalize the idea that I can move into a marriage with you and then move out of it when I get to a particular age or a particular developmental point where at this stage, like my love needs to look different. And it's tough. Like I'm coming from I am a Christian person. So when you say the vows, it's to death do us part. And I'm wondering about like that, when those initial vows were like written, what those relationships look like versus what we expect relationships to do now. Those are just some of the ideas that are like bouncing around in my head. And I'd be,
oh, great ideas.
Yeah.
One of the things we know from classical civilization, there is no death. So the expectation life cycle, Kepran philosophy says, symbolized by the scarab, we're born, we're reborn, and then we transform only to come again. So in that way, I think it ties into what you were saying, because while in this body, in this life, maybe we're a couple for a certain term, and then we grow, we change, something else is needed, but we're never separated, even into eternity. So as we shift our worldview and our conceptual, our ontological premise from the material aspect alone to a spiritual aspect, then I think that can help free us up so that some of the challenges that we face in long-term relationships become less challenging.
What I like about what Evan just did, and I connected with what JoJo did earlier, that Evan just dared to question a given. Rather than just take the pledge to death do us part, he's actually stepping back to interrogate, you know, our marital ritual. And then you can get a conversation about life and death, just like the creation story of so-called Adam and so-called Eve. To think about creation as something that happens every day, and so does death. And resurrection and death come daily, if not moment to moment. Just to interrogate that is so dissenting from the script that we be compliant robots, that in previous points in history, Evan would have been killed for doing that, because dissent cannot be tolerated. Interrogation can't be tolerated. I connected with JoJo because JoJo, in the middle of a conversation about Zola with all his profound depth, and I love the African concept of Zola, because productivity is built into all of the emotion, not separated. So JoJo was saying, in the middle of this conversation, I got something profound to say about Zola, but by the way, my dog is like jacking me up right now. So that ability in a savage society that has programmed us to be compliant robots competing against each other, that ability to interrogate and be honest would allow us, I think, out of Zola, to be in a relationship with anyone, including someone you're dwelling with, to say today, I'm scared. This is what scares me. This is what's really frightening about this moment. Or what I'm feeling and seeing now is a sense that we don't need to dwell together. Just think about how hard that would be without us really being grounded in something African, because everything is tilted toward pretend in your dating, pretend in your coupling, pretend in your relationships. Don't step on toes. Don't rock the boat. Don't interrogate deeply. That's what the culture insists on. And I just love it when JoJo tells us about a dog in the middle of going back to the scarab beetle. And, you know, it's just like, that's what's going to be our, quote, salvation. And I really think people don't get the root word of salvation, which is salve comes from a word which means whole, to make yourself or regard yourself or declare yourself or embrace yourself or put yourself in a position to be whole and healthy. So we end up in this society blaming each other, which is external condemnation, to set ourselves up for external salvation. And I think what Zola is teaching us is that whole model is sponsoring us for death and has nothing to do with the model of African civilizations, which was saying we must be complement and we must produce together, including the next generations, but we also need to do it out of, I don't think we would need to save ourselves. That may be the quickest way to say it. And when JoJo tells me about her dog and Evan says, I wanna look at this structure, I'm not just a fish swimming around wet, I'm gonna study the water, I'm thinking that's our salvation. We can save ourselves. Now suppose we commit that there's a set of people, can't do 7 billion all at once, there's a set of people that I won't lie to or pretend, because Zola requires us to love each other enough to engage each other. Opposite of love is not hate. It's actually disengagement, where you commit to yourself, not to each other. And when you read the poem, Nana Lemna, I start thinking about the guy saying, you bond my heart to life. That's somebody you can work with, but we gotta tell the truth and the whole truth, nothing but the truth. And then let the best idea emerge.
I know last time we talked about monogamy and its value. I think that's kind of what you were speaking to as well, Evan. And we don't know, although these ancient folk were generally monogamous, but we don't know what the implications of that are after 5,000 years of such insanity. So definitely, interrogating all those things is going to be essential. And that's why we love Zola Mondays. We just get to interrogate everything.
Yeah, I'm really like sitting here in deep thought because all the points that Evan brought up and then the connections that you all made are things that I do think about. And also I try to parse apart like what has been, what I've been socialized into wanting and thinking is realistic and what do I really want and what do I really think could work for myself. So specifically to the point of like monogamy or if people are married or in a committed long-term relationship or have committed to be together long-term, what does conscious like uncoupling look like for them? Or is it okay for that to happen? Which obviously the answer is yes, but when it does happen, the way that people look at you if you want to get a divorce or if things are no longer right for you all, you all's relationship. And then it also makes me think of the point that you brought up, Nana, about even if you split, you would be like eternally together. And I'm still like processing that and what that would look like if it's more of like a, if you had a spiritual connection with the person and what that, you know, what that means. But all those things are things that I'm trying to think through and figure out like what's realistic and what's not.
Absolutely, it's so important. And I think the idea of there being one love manifest in an infinite variety of ways. And at some level, I probably love in a different kind of way everybody ever loved. I'll always love them. I may not be with them, may not want to be with them, but I will still have that energy that we once shared. And that's an okay thing. I think by the same token, the idea that I'm in a relationship that now needs to shift. I think divorce is something that oftentimes is a good thing if it's not working and it's toxic to one or both parties, but it still has to be done in a loving way.
I agree. I think that in talking about leaning into our spirituality from an African perspective, a lot of the times we're sold these messages that love has to last forever. And we're, you know, we're soulmates and this, that, and the third. But the truth of the matter is, I feel like if people are not growing and static and staying with the same partners, then that's not really effective. And so I definitely believe in multiple loves or multiple soulmates across the lifespan. And I think that's a really interesting concept. And I'm also taking notes like Robina and thinking about that.
Well, soulmates is a wonderful idea, though, isn't it? And they are, I think you do have soulmates, but I don't know what that necessarily means in terms of what our day-to-day relationship might look like.
Well, it may mean that we have a sense or intuitive knowing that we are connected. So there's a unseen affinity or connection, and we might say a spiritual affinity to some people. I think it's fascinating when you get children involved, and everything about African civilization is thinking about making decisions that affect your great-grandchildren's great-grandchildren, that kind of mentality. So, you know, part of what's problematic is it's low cost to get hooked up, whether it's an entanglement, a situationship, or something that really you intend to be a partner, and it's very expensive to exit, you know, in this society. And it's done often without elder conversations. You know, we're really connecting with families. And by the time you have 12 generations, you've got over 4,000 people that are genetically and culturally influenced the person that you're now dating, and whether they know it or not. So it's very expensive to exit. And you don't actually separate, as Nana Linda says, philosophically, there's a way of thinking about this. So you're not separate, but you might not live together. But you really don't separate if you have children, because the force field you need to develop children is going to be affected. And what's amazing to me is to watch people beat children physically with a belt, a stick, or whatever they can grab, and then talk about the toxicity that they felt in the energy with the person that they made the children with. You know, so it's a really fascinating notion that you just said, Nananda, about us really loving and appreciating that we had energy with people at certain times and not getting so bent out of shape that we start bending out of shape the children out of our regret or disappointment in that energy moments that we shared. So it's very hard to avoid the script, which is ultimately kill yourself and your children without having some deep grounding in a true alternative. And I don't really see the evidence that people are in spaces where they can actually be nurtured, even think about this. So that's what would also create more spaces where the thinking that we're doing can happen with more, may all be fed so we can feed each other to think about our life and our great-grandchildren's great-grandchildren. You know, we're in a society that plans obsolescence and makes everything short-term and people expendable. And now we're talking about deep Zola. So it's gonna be a challenge, but I think the way to do it is to look at I've gotten to the point where I say everything that we've been exposed to is got to be up for investigation. We cannot assume that there's anything about this society that is worthy of us following it. And that gets me alert to look at everything, including people like to hook up with you and say, if you don't bother my donuts, I won't bother your vodka. If you don't call me fat, I won't call you skinny. So we end up negotiating with people, taboo, protective subtopics that we don't go there in order to have a kind of connection. I'm impressed with Zola as a concept of saying we must grow together, be productive together, be at peace together. And he says, just your call of your name calms my life. I just think about that peace that we won't have if I can't talk about your donuts and you can't talk about my vodka. We got to get to the point where there's no taboo topic and everything is available for interrogation.
Can I hop in really quick? That just like brought up that sparked a thought in my head is, I think at least in our current context, our specific context, you see that, right? The don't talk about my donut, don't talk about my drinking type of dynamic, because people view like relationships as the only, a lot of people, I'm not gonna use like a lot of people view relationships as the only way to get away from loneliness. And I think we have, especially in a pandemic context, but even prior to that, right? People lived in contexts in which their partner and the family that they might go on to create became their only social context, right? And so people kind of held on to these relationships because they were the only community that they could actually have. People kind of grew up in distancing themselves from friends that they made growing up, partners that they had, such that the romantic partner became the entirety of that person. And so to that end, it is more of like a trauma bond. It's not actually thinking about love, because love could be risky. Because it could be like we're talking about, I have an honest conversation about Zola and realize that at this stage, maybe we're not the best for each other. And so rather than figuring that out, you leave all that untouched just so you can stay in the boat that keeps you from drowning in the lonely society that people have created, right? So I think to the point that you're making, it's not just about like love in a dyad, right? Like me and my partner. It's about like, how do you shift the types of love that our society creates, right? Because then the fear about loneliness isn't there because you have a community to capture. And to that end, the last thing I was gonna say is I was watching a documentary, I think on Vox. I can't remember what exactly it was called. I can't remember the society, but they were talking about living in a particular village where the woman is extremely, you know, sexually active, is not at all frowned upon, it's normal, and will have so many partners that when she has a child, nobody in the village might not like know whose child it is. But the culture is that this is all our child. The kids here, like that's all our kid. I'm not worried about who the actual dyad is. It's about like, no, as a community, we're raising this person, right? And so what would it mean to be in a community where you have that much like love and care. It's tough. It's tough. So that's just where my head was.
Very interesting. I think that is very important to think about, because clearly what we have going isn't working that well. So alternatives that might be better, but the idea of a community being needed to raise a family or raise children, I think most people kind of get that, even though the social structure doesn't always contribute to it. So people move away from grandparents and parents and end up raising children by themselves as a couple, which is problematic, but also beginning to think about how family has to be more than blood relation. So family can be spiritual relation, which sometimes can be stronger than blood relation, and bringing a community together to support children in that kind of way could be very, very helpful. I also like the idea of women being very free. Just kidding.
Before we move on, someone on Facebook asked if we can reiterate what ZOLA is. So if one of the elders want to come in and remind us what exactly is ZOLA and why we are calling it Creating ZOLA Mondays.
Sure. I say it all the time. Do you want to say it, Dr. G?
Well, let me just start by saying it's one of the many words linguistically coming from African cultures. This is from Bantu culture, Zulu culture, that's capturing something really, really important for our lives, personally and collectively, which is this notion, this concept of coming together, grounded, in an understanding that we're not going to be vampires and cannibals. We're going to actually complement each other and be productive together. This is self-love being stacked with the love in connection with and complementarity with someone else. To me, that's key, that without that understanding, we're going to be seduced into thinking of love as a self-serving connection, as opposed to it's grounded in something that serves life and your community, and it's productive. You can't just say, I fell in love, and then nobody's growing, or there's no sign of your peace or your productivity in the world happening. So that's how I understand it. Nana, Linda, bounce off of that.
Yeah, I would agree. It's certainly a connection, a human connection that is, in most cultural traditions, seen as love is seen as essential. It's an energy, it's a connection. And so when we find most of the people who were kidnapped and trafficked to America as caste chattel, enslaved, are Bantu people. And then we find that the Kikongo from Central Africa to Southern Africa all have the same construct derived from classical civilization and brought to the Americas, then it's a very powerful notion that love and peace and tranquility and productivity kind of meld in a very significant way, so that we as a people can begin to love and be at peace and have the tranquility, which is the basis for energy for creativity, and the productivity to transform our lives and transform the world. Actually, we're really talking about the sustainability of humankind.
I love Evan's upgrading of the old TV show called The Love Boat. He just said, trauma bonding requires that we have TV shows called The Love Boat, but the real deal is people are jumping in the loneliness boat. And he's a shining light on all of the little tricks and traps that will be set up and disguised with the word love. And people don't have any grounding in what Nana Linda just described. Hopefully the reader that asked in the chat, what are you really talking about, is captured in the notion of we're talking about living a life supreme and transforming the world so that you're seeing yourself as a powerful agent, not someone entangled and on a loneliness boat, and you're trying to figure out how to suboptimally just survive. Nana Linda said, we're trying to transform the world, leave it better than we found it, which is actually the using the force of love, which is the greatest force that we know of. And our language in English stumbles because the same word is used for so many different things. And you can see where the powers that be set up a script where I don't have to ever meet you in life, but we both know the TV show, The Love Boat. And then we'll begin to get our notions of love based on our exposure to the oppressor's media. So hopefully that helps the audience members understand the courage it takes to interrogate the loneliness boat and ask, is there another ship that we can create? And when you want to create a ship, you don't actually want people to dwell on the micro nails and hammer and wood. You really want to do what Nana Linda and you folks are doing, and I'm honored to be with you. You want to get them excited about the journey. And we can make particular ships if you understand we're not talking about a loneliness boat to solve trauma bonding. Trauma bonding has to be looked at from the root, and we're going to deal with the root and branch. And the loneliness boat is a branch off of the root lie. And Zola is talking about the real truth. My heart longs for you to regain my life.
Life is a journey, and love is what makes the journey worthwhile. So
it's who we are. So off of that note, I'm curious to toss a question to Robina, who's in deep thought, or JoJo, if her dog will let her, or Evan, who's our resident interrogator. What do you feel at your point of the journey, the human journey, are the right scoreboards or markers of success in a relationship, so that we can begin to think about the just, and as Nana Linda likes to say, the just, sane, and sustainable markers, as opposed to the ones that are given to us, like they used to give out free candy cigarettes to recruit the next generation of people to smoke. So there's always this tension between what we intuit as the life-affirming markers. What is your generation? What are you witnessing and hearing and seeing among your peers as to what they count as true success in a relationship?
All right, Robina and JoJo are in the comments bullying me again, telling me I gotta go first. So I'm gonna go quick. To the point that you made, I do think it's two ways. There's no one right generational response, right? I do see a lot of people that buy into the classical idea of romantic love because I think there are people that view that as a potential tool for like anti-racism, right? I think part of maybe some of like the maybe initial framing of the overall conversation, or at least implicit in it, is that Black love is something that is there's a problem with it, right? And so people think by finding that ideal partner that is that has a beard and is a particular, you know what I mean? Like, it'll, that they can serve as an image, right? An image that shows that Black love is fine. They're playing a part, right? So I think there are people in our generation that buy into that, into the image of it, like the uplift suasion of it, I think some people would say. There are other people, I think, that are in other communities that I know there are people in certain queer communities that have been forced to reimagine how relationships can happen, right? And so you have people that are more honest and more truthful about what does love actually mean? Like, how could I actually survive in truth? And so I think there are also people who have been, in our generation, who've been incredibly radical in reimagining how love and relationships and partnerships can actually occur. So I've seen the both and everything in between. So that's my quick answer. JoJo looks like she wanted to go next.
You know what? I don't know. I'm still trying to learn every day. It's definitely an ongoing process. But what I can speak to is what hasn't worked for me in my past relationships and trying to cultivate, you know, that Zola. So what hasn't worked is like being possessive of my partner or other people's partners that I've witnessed having struggles in their relationship. That definitely doesn't work. And I think that speaks to, again, that spirituality and the understanding that we don't own each other or people, that we can experience them and we should be grateful for that, even if it is like a limited experience. And what also hasn't worked is just trying to check people off like they're a list. So like, oh, does this dude have a beard? Like, is he getting a PhD also? Is he like super smart and deep? Or, you know, is he like, I don't know, a gym rat? So that also hasn't worked. So I'm really interested to hear what Robina has to say.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, I feel like I have thoughts that are on similar to like what Evan mentioned and also similar to what JoJo mentioned. So for me, like when you initially asked the question and even when you brought it up earlier, I my first thought was I don't really know, because it's different with every person. Like even in familial relationships, I feel like that has been a basis for me to like really try and figure out how to love unconditionally. So to create Zola within my family relationships, like with my siblings or my parents, and then moving from there into, because I think for me, it's like, I don't want it to be like, oh, I can have successful relationships with friends or other people, but within my family, I can't kind of, you know, make things work with them. And obviously there are, you know, stipulations to that too, because some people have very toxic family relationships, and so it's not a matter of like forcing it. But yeah, so for me, I think of how it works in different ways. So something that hasn't worked for me also, and like what JoJo mentioned, some people might know this from like if they watched Nipsey Hussle or Hermias's funeral, but Lauren London had said something that he usually would tell her about like not possessing people, but like experiencing them. And that's kind of what I've been trying to lean more into, is like this person is not mine and I'm not theirs either. And so what freedom looks like in relationships, and for me, who wants to be in like a monogamous relationship, how can I achieve that while also allowing the other person to feel like they can be themselves and not feel like they have to hide who they are, or not feel like they can step out of certain like cultural, traditional Western expectations of them in order to like be loved by me or for me to love them. So I'm still figuring it out, but I want to lean more into not being possessive and more experiencing the person. And then in the definition, as you were describing, Dr. Gordon, I like how you ended up emphasizing the productivity part of like living love, being what are we kind of adding to the world and what are we adding to each other? So still trying to figure it out. I don't know if that answers the question.
Those are great answers.
Those are great answers.
I think one of the things that might be helpful too in thinking about what a successful relationship is to think about what is a successful life. What is a successful life? Because as we pursue a successful life outside of the Western definitions of success, which clearly need to be examined, we can then think about, okay, if this is what I want and need for a successful life, how can other human relationships contribute? How can I contribute? So it becomes a collective endeavor that's not so small that that we get kind of choked up, like, oh, well, the checklist didn't work, or oftentimes in dyads, people are looking for a committed relationship, but choose wrong. And therefore, eventually that bad choice is gonna play out in dysfunction in the relationship. And if we can think about it as a life process, and it's a growth process, and it's okay to change, it's okay to acknowledge, you know, that was not the best decision, but that's okay, I'm gonna live with it and I'm gonna go on. I think just stepping away from the Western notion of what's best or what success is will go a long way in terms of helping us to realize what would be true success in a tradition of wisdom and deep thought.
You know, just to piggyback, Donna Linda, you've done something to step away from the West to me, because you said no matter what question we are examining, success in relationship, that question is embedded in a bigger question. Mm-hmm. And that connects us to something bigger than our moment or the micro question that we're looking at. So one, I think that's a step away. Two, I love Robina's answer, because to me, I think the salvation quotes is in us being honest with each other, including not pretending to know and be clear. But Robina and others are saying, I'm coming clear. I'm coming clear. You know, and I lose it sometimes, or depending on the context, it's a little different challenge. So I think that's not Western either. We get graded for outcomes in school so much that we feel like we got to know the right answer. I think the co-panelists are teaching us something about how to be African, which is stay in process and of coming clear. And then the last thing I want to harvest is something that's so profound. I hope people listening will write this down, that Robina started, we're saying it in different ways. JoJo said it differently, but the point is about possession. You know, the idea that we would spend so much time as a captive people bemoaning our captivity, and then look around and say, in my relationship, I didn't have a problem with slavery. I just wanted a slave of my own. Somebody that I could get a ring, put a ring on it. Somebody that I could possess. Somebody I could get jealous over. And I think by stating it the way you did, you're showing us that the light, how to get out of this trap, that we were called here with gifts to express our gifts and to complement each other to do that so that the world can be different, not to own people. And I think subtle ways we've been programmed to endorse slavery. And that's exactly what the script would call for. Today, you folks have named the problem, but you've also named the solution, which is we don't need to treat each other like that. We are energy exchanges coming together. Let's amplify experience, not try to own it and control it.
So very true, so very true. If we can move to a place where we are expansive in our understanding of life and love and ourselves and one another, it would be very, very powerful. Any closing thoughts from JoJo or Evan or Robina?
What I gathered from this conversation is that I need to, while I'm looking for or in Black love or involved in it, I need to give myself some grace and some patience, and also just keep that peace in mind that I'm not looking to reiterate Western cultural values with regard to love and looking to own a slave. I'm just trying to experience people and exchange energy, and I think that will take me far.
So. Absolutely.
I was gonna say, I think the biggest thing I always leave these conversations with is a reminder about being brave in how we explore and create new ideas, because that's how you achieve, whether that be an optimal relationship, an optimal way of being in community with other people. And I think that applies to every single topic that we discuss. So that, I'm always just left kind of sitting back and appreciative of being in a context where I get to do that with so many brilliant people. So That's what I'm thinking about right now.
Great. Robina?
Yeah, thank you. I'm also grateful to be able to share the space and to just get all the wisdom from you all. I think that the perspectives that you all share, many of them are ones that I've thought through, but being able to hear it from a very Zola'd perspective is really helpful to me. And I think for me, I'm gonna continue like mulling over the stuff, and I just wanna continue to like live truthfully and authentically. So whatever that looks like as having more conversations like this and leaning away from like Western ideals of what relationships look like and more of zoloing up on myself and my people.
Excellent.
Listening is an act of love, and it's one of my markers of success. Listening to yourself and investing in people that are willing to listen to you. I'm looking for partners and people that are willing to listen long enough to let you finish a sentence before they compete to impress you or recoil from what you're investigating. So I think that one of the things we can do is be inspired to listen going forward. Look forward to our next conversations. Thank you.
Well, you know, one of the things psychologists are good at is listening. And so, or hopefully they're good at listening. But it's also true that sharing, heartfelt sharing is so, so important. And particularly when it's in terms of gender relations, we really, really, really need to work at sharing how we really feel. Women are kind of good at sharing what we really feel. Men, I don't know. But whatever we can do to enhance that capacity is so very important, because I think a lot of times, particularly from the feminine side, we leave conversations thinking, okay, we have the opportunity here to really Zola up and open up and create space for that world of love and peace and tranquility and productivity. See you next time.